To remain totally silent is to produce violence. Silence is violence. When the people of God should be rising up, letting their voices be heard, speaking out and acting up, and they remain totally silent, it results in the violence of people being left in cold, dark homes, people being left out on the streets, so much hurt and so much pain. God is calling forth His people at this hour.
Whether it's a heat crisis, severe cold spell, or a person without a home, New Life Evangelistic Center is engaged with the hurting in mid-America. Around the clock, staff labor to help those in hopeless situations. In order to be able to reach out in this way, the NLEC staff find singing, praying, and worshiping God together to be essential in their labor of love. We invite you now to join Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of the New Life Evangelistic Center as they worship God together with the fatherless, widowed, and homeless. Let the same Holy Spirit who strengthens them daily minister to you as you join them in renewing your commitment to serve our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in reaching out to the world around us.
Silence is violence, and it's so easy to remain totally silent in the face of so many injustice and so much hurt. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, I'm asking you to give us faith and courage and strength and determination at this hour, Lord God. It's so easy, Lord, just to remain silent as we see injustice sweep across our land. As we see hurt and we see pain, Lord God, we see people in spiritual darkness and blindness headed toward the ultimate violence of hell itself. Give us faith, give us courage, give us determination, Lord, to speak up and speak out in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We live at a time when right looks wrong and wrong looks right. The people that are doing wickedness try to look like they're doing the right thing, and then they even try to come down on the people that are trying to engage in righteousness. We see this. It becomes so socially acceptable to just kind of look the other way and ignore people who are in homes without any heat, to ignore people sleeping up and down our streets, and say you want to continue to raise taxes to build a soccer stadium or a football stadium, or to come up with money for the games of the rich and the powerful. Why, so many people are hurting at this time. And this happens so repeatedly that many good people just remain silent. And for evil to prevail, all it takes is for good people to do nothing. Why is it that so many people remain silent? Why political leaders can always find money for sporting complexes, but nothing for affordable housing, and growing numbers of people are left in the violence of homelessness? As silence sweeps throughout our community, violence is destroying the lives and hearts and homes of so many people. I've heard the stories of the desperation that many of you have had, and that the violence that you experienced in your life. But now you're coming into the fullness and the power of Jesus. And as you experience that fullness and power of Jesus, as He shows you that there is hope, that He is risen, you must also be able to speak up and speak out at this time. Making the choice to speak up and speak out can be challenging when it comes to standing up for the rights of the elderly, the poor, the fatherless, the widowed, the hurting. Being advocates for those in need cause us to ask the hard questions. Why do the rich and powerful get all the tax abatements and the right of eminent domain, which results in so many people to be left out on the streets with adequate housing and without adequate assistance? As advocates, we have to ask, what's wrong with a free market that doesn't create adequate affordable housing and yet promotes the conversion of apartments that people used to live in into condominiums for the rich and for the powerful? This act of violence is taking place against the poor, the fatherless, the widowed, the hurting, the homeless. In James chapter 1, last verse says, this is true and perfect religion, to remember the fatherless and the widowed in their affliction and to keep oneself unstained from the world. How we need the power of God to come upon us at this time. We need the Holy Spirit to move in us so we can break out of our prisons of silence. As we see neighborhoods redlined, meaning that along with come lending associations, and they won't loan to poor people in that particular area. They won't loan to landlords that want to rent out to poor people in that area. Unless there's this, and they'll just allow the area to totally deplete until they give it to rich and powerful folks that come in and build their condominiums, and then they want to push the poor and the needy out of the area. Something's wrong with all that. And it's easy for us to feel as we see all this wrong and we see this hurt, we see this pain, this injustice take place around us, to feel totally powerless. And I want to declare to you that in the middle of all this, that there is hope. Christ is risen. Can you say that? There is hope. Christ is risen. Because some of you, I believe, are feeling hopeless right now. You're feeling down. You're feeling out. But there is hope. Christ is risen. I've seen something happen as they've come along and tried to do everything they can. I'm talking about the elitists, the power brokers, those that would try to engage us in legal lynchings with all their stuff. As I begin to see them taking away the parking, and I begin to see them do all this, that, and the other as we try to do the work of God, I've seen a new resolve. I've seen a new determination. I've seen a new willingness. I met one of our staff on the way in here, Brother Dante, who's out at our transmitter, saying, I want you to know that we're praying for you out here. They're not going to shut you down. And more people are saying that, and more people are believing that, and more people are experiencing that. People are coming forth that never put forth came forth because they know that there is hope. Christ is risen. And they're speaking up, speaking out. Thank you, Jesus. We're told in Amos chapter 5, verse 24, let justice roll on like a river, righteousness like a never-failing stream. Now, when you study Amos chapter 5, verses 21 to 24, you're going to see that the prophet Amos cries out that if our faith does not bring justice flowing like a river, then we should stop the noise we're making at our religious gatherings. And the reason for this is because God gets tired of hearing it unless what we call praise is followed by acts of justice. And that's what's so critical at this particular time, that we let the acts of justice begin to flow through us and in us. Now, for many folks, justice means just us, but that's not the biblical definition of such. You see, homelessness is the end result of social Darwinism of the 21st century. And you're familiar with Darwinism. It's the survival of the fittest. And we begin to see this, that, you know, those that think that they're fit and they got the money, they don't want the others around. And if we don't have no money, they don't consider us fit. And, then they would try to run us out of the neighborhood. But I want to tell you, Jesus, who do you identify with? The fatherless, the widowed, the homeless, didn't he? He said, foxes have holes and birds have nests, but he, the Son of Man, had nowhere to lay his head. Matthew chapter 8, verse 20. And I want to be among Jesus and his people, don't you? And so that's where we have an opportunity to stand steadfast. There's no book which more precisely addresses the cause and solutions for homelessness than the Bible. And in the Bible, we find over 2,000 verses which relate to the poor. Although it points out how people can end up homeless as a result of the wrong choices, and you're well aware of the story of the prodigal son, it also challenges those who claim to be people of God to reach out to those who are in need. As individuals that say we're followers of Jesus, we need to re-examine his mission. And what's Jesus' mission? How did he lay out his mission statement? Here it is. Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And what was that year of the Lord's favor? Jesus died on the cross. He rose from the dead. And we began to see the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We began to see him do the mighty, mighty things began to take place. So are we going to choose to believe God? Are we going to choose to believe a materialistic system that causes us to feel like we're less than human if we don't have more money than somebody else, more stuff than somebody else? The capitalistic system just keeps feeding itself on getting more and more junk that we don't need. Are we going to come to Jesus, who says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest? And that's what he wants to do right now. Give us a rest and a peace that passes all understanding. You know, in order to preach the good news to the poor, proclaim freedom to prisoners, recovery of sight to the blind, and freedom to the oppressed, we've got to confront the greed and self-centeredness in our own life. That's what it means that Jesus has come to set the captives free. We confront this greed and self-centeredness in our own life, and we see that we can only have freedom as we experience the forgiveness of sins that only Christ provides. And if we're going to be liberated from this tyranny of sin that controls our personal lives, we got to let Jesus be our Messiah and not our mascot. To a lot of people, Jesus is their mascot. He's the one that they look to that to kind of help give them the okay to keep doing what they're doing, even if it's not right. But Jesus is calling us right now to repentance, to experience the freedom that only he can give us at this particular moment. And when we come to God and we surrender to Jesus, we experience what it is to be totally set free. Jesus has come to set the captives free. Now, this freedom means that we don't have to be anxious. And I have to confess to you that there's times that anxiety will try to sweep over me. You ever had that happen to you? To start worrying about a lot of stuff, and you ever do that? Anybody really start worrying? Well, that's why Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 is so important that we not only know what it says, but we can apply it. He says, do not be anxious about anything, but everything in prayer and petition with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. Now, I want you all to hear that, because some of you, God is really trying to get your attention at this moment. Some of you, you know, you're looking to people, and then when people don't meet your need, he'll work through people. But I want to tell you something. He wants to take us beyond that into his very presence. And that's what he wants to do in the lives of each one of us right now. I can't meet all your need. I can't meet much of your need at all, but Jesus can. I can help you as His love flows through me, but there's times and there's many limits as far as what I can do, but He is limitless. And it's important that you come to know Him. Because if you depend on me or anybody else, you're going to get anxious. And He says, be anxious about nothing, but everything with prayer and supplication, with prayer and petition, with thanksgiving. Who? Let your requests be made known unto God. You know that? Some lady was just kind of pouring out one thing after another yesterday, and she wanted me to do this, that, and the other. I said, lady, you need to go talk to God first before you come talk to me. I mean, you might have been one of them that I said that to. But that's true. I can't do it. He can, right? So we got to come to Him, right? We got to come to Him. And that's, again, it's a speaking out, and I have to tell you that, because silence results in all this need and hurt and violence on your part. We got to know it. We got to come to Jesus. Trusting in Jesus to meet every need allows Him to be our Messiah and not our mascot in the game of life. As our Messiah, Jesus is our Savior and Master who will never leave us nor forsake us. Psalm 82, verse 3 says, tells all of us to defend the poor and the fatherless, do justice to the afflicted and the needy. And as I read these scriptures, I have to ask myself, how can I say I'm desiring to do the will of God and then do nothing? Because silence is violence. Now, you know, some folks, in knowing this, and I'll come back to what I shared just a moment ago, I know that only God can meet all your needs. But if I tell you, okay, be well, that's good, God will take care of you, and I'll pray for you and send you down your way, and don't do what I can do for you, then that's wrong, because the Bible says to him or her to know to do good and doeth it not, it's a sin. And some of you all know that God has told you you need to do things, but all you're doing is giving your excuses rather than your life. We have to give him our excuses? No, we have to give him our life, don't we? So we come to our point and we say in this life where we say, okay, Lord, I know I'm not doing everything that I can be doing with myself. And so what I need to do is I need to ask you to forgive me, and it's called repentance. You're going the wrong way. What do? You make a U-turn and go the right way, don't you? That's what he wants us to do. Well, whether it's the needy who are locked up daily without adequate legal defense, or the poor and elderly who are having their homes taken away from them through laws that benefit the greedy developers, I got to seek God as to what decisive actions I'm supposed to take, and you too. Now, it's easy for you to just continue to see yourself as constantly in need. Well, we're all constantly in need, and I got to roll those needs over to God. I just got through reading to you from Philippians 4:19 there. I got to roll them over for God, and then I've got to let His power and Spirit work in me, because if I don't do that, I'll be paralyzed with fear, worry, unbelief, and anxiety. And remember, Jesus has come to set the captives free, and you're always going to be silenced if you're overwhelmed by that stuff, fear, worry, anxiety. But let Jesus set you free, and then you can begin to be free to seek Him. Because the only lasting antidote, and that means the only lasting cure to despair, which is an integral part of poverty and injustice, is the hope that the living Christ can bring. Catch that? You're always going to feel down and out and hurting and needy if you don't come to the source, if you don't come to Jesus right now. This hope is reflected in the lives of those who answer the call to follow Jesus. He's the one who's standing in solidarity with the poor, the elderly, and the oppressed. And answering this call, you know, when he said, okay, Lord, I'm willing to do whatever you want me to do, sometimes means being involved in acts of civil disobedience. That means doing things that you know that local government has set up these laws that totally violate Scripture, and you just don't obey them, and then you get locked up for such and put in jail. It's happened to me on quite a few occasions, okay? Well, it also involves feeding the hungry, sheltering the homeless, and letting the love of God flow through us. A knowledge of the need is not enough. As 1 Corinthians chapter 8, 1 says, knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Did you catch that? Sometimes we want to get more and more knowledge. Well, that knowledge will puff us up, but love will build us up. Lord, we need love. The Bible tells us, whoever stoppeth his ears at the cry of the poor, he also shall cry himself, but not be heard. Proverbs 21, 13. Over and over, the Bible makes it clear that silence is violence. Now, there's a federal law. It's called the Stuart B. McKinney Homeless Assistance Act. And you know what it says? A lot of folks don't even know about it, because rich folks don't want you to know about it. It says that federal surplus property needs to be used to help the homeless. The tragedy is only 1% ends up in the hands of the poor and homeless to help them. The other 99% goes to these rich developers. We saw this happen with the Abram building over here. Federal surplus property should be used to help the homeless. What did they do? City Hall robbed it and made it City Hall West, I think is what they call it. Okay, now, and the homeless out here. And then we see them trying to come and just destroy the last major walk-in shelter. Well, yeah, well, you know, evil tries to do what it can, but good people, by standing up, praying, getting involved, we can stop that, can't we? We got it. Silence is violence. To leave people out on the streets, and you know what it is personally, alone and suffering and feeling no one loves you, that's a violence. And that's why we as members of the body of Christ need to reach out and embrace one another. Maybe you're in need now, but let the Spirit of God work in you and strengthen you. Receive the love Jesus is trying to show you to strengthen you to reach out and love other people. The Bible tells us in Proverbs 14, verse 31, he that oppresses the poor reproaches his maker, but he that honoreth him has mercy on the poor. When one's homeless, you know this, nearly everything they do after 10 o'clock at night is illegal. You're in the park, they tell you you can't be here. They don't put public bathrooms out, but if you go to the bathroom in public, there's a $100 fine for it, okay? You know, there's rest areas that they have when you travel up and down the highway for folks that got money in cars, pull over, they can rest. Where are the rest areas in the big cities where people walk around? Don't have them, right? Something's wrong. Why, you know, why are the people that are homeless subjected night after night to the torture of sleep deprivation as the people of God get a good night's sleep, remain silent and active? Something's wrong. Silence is violence. We've got to begin to pray. We need revival in our community at this particular time. Some religious folks would say, but it's not the job of the church to take care of people. It's not the job of the government to take care of people is what they say. They say they won't come right out and say it's not the job of the church because they know the Bible tells them different. They just act that way. They say, well, it's not the job of the government to take care of people. It's the job of the church. Well, show me the churches that are letting people sleep on their pews and letting people come in and stay with them then. We've got to start doing what Jesus has told us to do. Because as Matthew 25:40 says that as often you've done to the least of these, he said, even so, you've done unto me. You know, when are we going to let Jesus come back into our churches? This will happen as we hear him tell us to rise up and walk and be healed of the paralysis of fear. Then not only will we start asking the hard questions about justice for the homeless, but we'll begin demonstrating the courage necessary to let God use us to be the answer to those questions. Now we need to ask God for the courage to break out of the bondage of fear that caused us to remain silent. When we say nothing, we're actually afraid to do something. Courage is doing what you're afraid to do. It's taking action when you're feeling fear. Courage is fear that said its prayers. You hear that? Courage is fear that said its prayers. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. Now, if you're just experiencing a spirit of fear, be honest with yourself and say, Lord, this spirit I'm feeling is not of you. You have not given me a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind, right? So that's what we need to begin to understand. That's what he's trying to tell us to do. And stop trying to think that, you know, you can't expect somebody else to do it all for you. You're going to have to right now open your heart and your mind and receive Jesus and experience it. Just stand up against that fear in the name of Jesus. Stand up. Stand steadfast. Let God's power and love work in you. Romans 8:28 says, all things work together for good to them who love God and are called according to his purpose. Even the stuff you're going through now, you don't understand. And all the troubles. Now, let's just experience his peace. Claim Isaiah 26:3. Thou will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon thee because he trusts in thee, O Lord. Lord, I don't understand what you're doing right now. I'm standing on the promise of your word. I know that what I'm going through right now is going to work out for good. And so, Lord, I'm just asking you right now to grant me your peace and your grace. The peace of God is not the absence of stress. It involves first accepting Jesus as Lord and Savior and living a life when we obey him. And such a walk of obedience, though, often puts us in direct conflict with the power brokers of this world who are the actual perpetuators of much of the violence in the world we live in today. The prophets of the Scripture boldly proclaim that there's no peace for the wicked. We see that all over in the Scripture, Isaiah 57:21. Isaiah 59:8, Jeremiah 6, verses 14, and Jeremiah 8:11, Ezekiel 13:10 and 16. But even in the midst of the conflict, Isaiah would proclaim, as we indicated in Isaiah 26:3, thou wilt keep him or her in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed upon thee, because he trusts in thee, O Lord. And we need to understand that at this moment. And I know that some right now, your mind is just going up and down, the trouble's coming in, the worry's coming in. And we just want to say, Lord, I'm going to abide in your presence. I'm going to seek your direction. I'm going to do what you're calling me to do. And I'm going to believe you right now for the miracles that I need in my life in the name of Jesus. The key to contentment as we speak up and speak out is the absolute assurance that Jesus has given us everything we need to be victorious. 1 Corinthians 15:57 and 1 John 5:4. And as Philippians 4:13 indicates, this ability to live triumphantly in spite of the circumstances comes from Christ's power flowing in us and through us. And in spite of the powers of the system, we can victoriously declare in word and deed, as Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ Jesus who gives me strength. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And it's critical that we draw that strength from Jesus daily. If we're going to fight violence by speaking up and speaking out, we got to understand that God is calling us at this moment, for He tells us to be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks around seeking whom he may devour. I know it's Satan. He's so angry because God is turning people's lives around. People that his lives were broken and frustrated and the point of despair and suicide, I see him come into the place. I see him get a place to sleep. I see him get food to eat. And the devil wants to shut it down because souls are getting saved. And when we look at the scriptures, though, and see God moving his people from the comfort zone to the faith zone, it seems he keeps putting them in unequal fights. Yeah, it seems like the enemy has all the power, all the money, all the political resources, and we have nothing. Yet moving forth by faith involves letting God take our nothingness and replace it with his almightiness. This causes the giants to fall like Goliath did for David. It also causes the walls to fall like Jericho did for Joshua. Our armies ambushing themselves like they did for Jehoshaphat. Fearlessness is not the absence of fear, it's a mastery of fear with the knowledge that God is in control. Now, Jesus demonstrated the courage to speak up and act out when he confronted the power brokers and helped those in need to exercise strength and peace. He's forever associating with the needy. You see that in Luke chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. He'd eat with them, as Luke chapter 5, verse 27 to 32 says. He'd comfort them, as Luke chapter 12, 22 to 34 says. He'd feed them, as Luke chapter 9, verse 10 through 17 says. Jesus wasn't afraid to restore them to health, as Luke chapter 5, verses 12 to 16 said. And he ministered to them, as Luke chapter 7, 18 to 23 said. Jesus knew that silence and apathy result in the violence of hunger, sickness, oppression, and hell. And Paul was deeply committed to remembering the poor. In Galatians chapter 2, verses 7 to 10, we see that. He says, remember the poor. And Mother Teresa once said, in the faces of the poor and hungry, we'll see the face of Christ. It was Jesus who said, whatever I assuredly tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these, my brothers, my sisters, you did it for me. Isn't it time we started acting courageously and saying, yes, Lord, here I am. Now use me for your glory. Help me, Lord, to experience your inner peace as I ask the hard questions of myself, my church, my community. And these questions will bring about changes that are urgently needed at this time. You know, in one way or another, all of us are homeless in this world. We're seeking direction. We're seeking purpose. We're seeking a sense of belonging. And Jesus has provided that for it. He's conquered sin, death, and the devil. And he's come to give us life and given its fullness. Now, hell is that place of ultimate violence. And when I say that silence is violence, I mean that we need to recognize this, that, you know, hell is that place where it's the violence that includes an eternity of hatred and hopelessness, where a person's forever separated from Jesus. Now, if you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior and you remain silent, silence is violence. It ultimately ends up that way. If Jesus is your Lord and Savior, and you know that silence when it comes to sharing the eternal life he provides, is he violence? Then you're going to want to speak out, because you know that Romans chapter 6, verse 23 declares, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. That's eternal life. You don't have to go to hell. You don't have to live in hell. As many as call upon the name of the Lord, they shall be called the children of God. But it's critical we receive Jesus now as our Lord and Savior to the extent we're no longer remain silent in the violence of hell that's swallowing up millions day after day. Believers must share with the lost and lonely that there's hope because Christ is risen. Now, I know some people will say that. They'll speak about that and they'll share Jesus to help people not to go to hell, but they can't recognize the hell people are in right now. Jesus was able to put it all together. He didn't just talk about some pie in the sky when you die. He knew that you were living in death and hopelessness in the here and now. He reached out. He said, come to me, all you who labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He fed the hungry, sheltered, and reached out and cared for people. And he tells us to do the same thing. And as we do that, we want to share with people that it's not always going to be this way. That Jesus has come to show us that it's not going to be this way. Jesus has told us that he's gone to go prepare a place for us. If it was not, if it were not so, he would have told us. He says, I'm going to take you to that particular place. You know, we can no longer wait. You and I got to speak up and speak out and tell everyone we know that, you know, to believe in Jesus, to trust in him, to cling to him, to depend on him. Now we're left with a decision. Are we going to give in to fear, anxiety, and hopelessness where silence is violence? God has placed us at this moment in history, in this time and place. Are we going to believe the scriptures and put our faith in the living God? He tells us in Philippians 4, verse 7, that as we put our faith in God, we can experience peace. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Do y'all hear that right now? Some of your minds and hearts are really troubled right now. Listen to what he's saying here. And the peace of God that transcends all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. We each know how some during the past few weeks have refused to accept this peace and they've just left. But what about you? Are you going to cast all your anxiety on Him knowing He cares for you? Are you going to let the peace of God that passes all understanding fill your heart and mind as you faithfully serve Him? Will you continue to courageously serve Jesus as we speak up and act out against the violence of injustice? As we face the uncertainty of the future with those with money and power who would love to crush us and our work among the poor, let's move forth in the peace of God that passes all understanding. Yes, it may be hard at times. Remember, courage is fear that has said its prayers to the one who's promised, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Now, if your courage has cold feet right now, remind yourself of the times in your life that God has come through for you in what seemed like impossible circumstances. Refuse to remain silent at this time of violence. Stay in the scriptures. Build yourself up on the fact that God has sent Jesus and that He has promised He'll be with you always, even to the end of the world. And let's continue to move forward, knowing that greater is He, Jesus, who's in us, than that lion, that giant Satan, who walks around seeking may devour. We need to come to Him right now. Some of you have wandered away from Him. Some of you are being tormented day and night. Day and night. When God has called you at this particular time to receive Him and to do a very special and powerful work for Him, we got to come to Him right now. Can we do that? Can we pray together? Can we say, Lord, I need You. I'm asking You, Lord, right now to please forgive me for all my sins. Pour Your Holy Spirit upon me. Help me, Lord, not to remain silent, but to share that there is hope, Christ, because You are risen. Help me to live out that hope, Lord, for I know that silence is violence, and I'm tired of violence. I want Your peace, Lord, that passes all understanding. I want Your purpose, Lord. I want Your power, Lord. Pour it out on me, Lord. Free me. Set me free now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Did you believe that? Did you receive that? Is you going to go forth from here right now? Are you going to go forth in His peace, His power, His promises, His purpose that passes all understanding? We cannot remain silent and claim that we know the One who's the way, the truth, and the life and not share it with others. And that doesn't mean just with our mouth. That means with our very being. That means letting Christ's light and love flow through us. That means confronting principalities. That means confronting powers. That means letting the power of God work in us and through us. So we can go forth now in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, with His peace and power that passes all understanding, knowing that greater is He that's in us than he that's in the world, and they shall not defeat us because Christ lives in us, and we are more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. Thank You, Jesus. Let's go forth in His power, His presence. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC, along with the fatherless, widowed, and homeless in their midst, ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior. You can receive an audio version of this message by sending a gift of $3 or more to NLEC, P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri 63166. And please specify the program number and title of this message.
You feeling lonely, fearful, depressed, discouraged? Then call the dial-a-message at this time, 314-241-7000.